I talked to a friend over the phone about being nervous to go back to school for my senior year, about the boys I've been caught up with. She listens quietly, and I imagine her spreading avocado on a bagel or painting her nails as she did when we lived closer. When I'm done, she stops, thinks, and tells me hunger makes you a modern girl before making it the title of her next Spotify playlist. I believe her. I take one grape off my plate in the morning and leave the rest for dinner. I'm dizzy, I don't eat. I'm tired, I don't sleep. I'm thirsty, I don't drink. I let them twist and pull and tug, this way and that, lips and drool and fingernails, and am I a modern girl yet? I remember one of these boys distinctly. I almost told him to stop, but it didn't seem worth it, so instead I studied his hunger. The way he moved and purred and whispered. His words were slow and planned, and his palms twisted around my wrists so that if he weren't kissing down the side of my neck, I'd mistake it for my deceased grandfather's Indian burns. Doesn't he know this means nothing by now? I could do this in my sleep because I've known men like him my whole life. Doesn't he know? Girls stretched too thin will eventually starve themselves, and I do. Calories become a game. I get myself down to 200 a day. I skip breakfast, have half an avocado for lunch and yogurt for dinner. In 1 month, I lose 7 pounds and it still doesn't feel like enough. I want hunger. I want his hunger. I want to feel him making up for what I've lost. This is what will happen. Before I meet him, I'll spend an hour making sure I look like I got ready in 5 minutes. Making sure I look naturally beautiful and expensive. But he can't know that I've done this to myself. I'll have to put on makeup and shave and brush through my hair a million times. I'll have to turn out the light so he can't see the cuts on my hands or the bruises on my knees or my skin that's barely stretched over my bones. No, he can't know what I've done. Can't see that I'm just as stupid and hungry as he is. I want to call my friend and tell her all of these things. I want to imagine her laughing and nodding her head in approval as I ask through the phone again. Am I a modern girl yet? Thank you.
Hi, my name is Stefania Bielkina. And for a while, I didn't think I'd be able to do this. I've never sat in front of a camera before, and as it turns out, I've never done an onslaught of things before, but I'm doing this because nobody else will. You know, back in December, I had a whole speech prepared. I thought I'd fly out to New York, do this in real life, in front of a crowd, and I haven't given up that hope, but frankly, I'm terrified that I'm doing something wrong. I'm terrified that I will mess this up and let the many people I've supported me throughout this journey down. And I'm terrified that after nights of working on the perfect speech for the perfect audience, I'm left in front of a camera with almost nothing. Stumped. But let me start from the beginning. Better yet, let me introduce myself to you. I'm the kind of person who once thought she had everything figured out. Big things, like I knew where I wanted to go to college, what I wanted to major in, but also little things, how I was going to my hair on a specific day, when I was going to wash my hair, whether I'd risk splattering eyeliner onto my brow bone or go for naturel. The point is, ever since I got accepted to what I used to believe is everything I've ever wanted, the art school of my dreams, I've been the star student. Perfect 4.0, perfect smile, perfect hairstyle. And yet I still feel like I'm living a quadruple life. Assertive, confident, easygoing, funny, excruciatingly dirty-minded, excruciatingly introverted at times. The smart kid in Algebra 1, you catch my gist. But this isn't going to be me exposing my supposed identity crisis to you guys. This is me finally coming clean about the underbelly of it all. Truth is, the assertive smile I used to wear whilst gallivanting down my school halls was the smile of a bulimic. The smile of what I thought was a disgusting, worthless, lying mess of a creature that deserved what she herself inflicted. Day by day, I grew obsessed with calorie counting. I would go to the gym for 2 hours every day and return staggering. I would purge myself of all the Pop-Tart and Twix binges in the toilet and lie when my roommate found chunks of evidence on the linoleum. I was a freak, someone your parents would point to at a gathering and ask whether you want to end up like them, and yet not quite sick enough to ask for help or treatment. I could express myself in what I secreted, purge myself of all the negativity, and have enough time to masquerade as the star student who never doubts herself. All that I once revered about myself was stripped away from me as I fasted on weeks on end before lapsing into binge purging cycles. My periods stopped coming regularly. I degraded myself over and over in order to please the constant voice inside of me that I needed to let it all out. But this isn't a sob story. This is an intervention for society. I'm recovering from bulimia. I am a member of the ED, the eating disorder community. This is an intervention world. This is who I am. This is who we are. And these are our stories. Now, I'm not going to preach the horror of Western culture. And if you've expected a tangent about that, you might as well just ditch this video altogether and continue binging some crappy Netflix TV show in your parents' basement. We all know that our media seeds unhealthy expectations of ourselves within us. We all know that the models, catalogs, and TV alike portray are unrealistic and heavily retouched. We all know these things, and we all confront these things every day since they pretty much surround us. You can't escape the media, but although it is terrible just how judgy our society has become, that's a much smaller role in the onset of ED as you might initially assume. If you're anything like me, the first time the concept of ED was introduced to you, it was followed by electron beauty standards and self-esteem boosters. So it might seem crazy at first when I announce just how little Western culture contributes to perpetuating ED, but hear me out. If the primary cause of ED onset is Western culture, how come not everybody has experienced it? We are surrounded by unrealistic beauty standards. What makes me different from my friend, for instance, who may be just as insecure as I am, but who hasn't partaken in any ED-related behavior? Why am I recovering from bulimia and they aren't? Before we dive into the biology of eating disorders, let's talk environment. An enormous factor in our environment that people rarely talk about when discussing ED is the obesity phobia imposed on us by our society. Many families are noticing that onsets of eating disorders in children and adolescents are being triggered by school-conducted obesity prevention programs. And it would make sense that school life impacts children's mental health at such a radical degree. A study in 2001 reported that 24% of girls and 17% of boys in third grade were on a diet, but as is common for roughly 15 to 20% of us, periods of food restriction often lead to overeating and ultimately weight gain and even obesity. It's a cruel cycle, and when institutions across America started requiring kids to write food diaries and to track their exercise as part of their curriculum in 1999, it only made the situation worse. In fact, schools had even begun sending BMI assessments, also dubbed BMI report cards, to children's families and homes in 2003, Arkansas being the first to do so. A sixth grader from Arkansas called Jane Rawson suffered greatly because of how irresponsibly her school enacted their so-called wellness program. When one day in class, she and her peers were called one by one to have their BMIs calculated and read aloud, she was exposed to smothering dissatisfaction with her own body, even though her BMI had always been normal. Anorexia soon followed and haunted her all the way to adulthood. But even with these statistics and this pretty startling info, we still don't answer the question, why them? Why 24% of girls and 17% of boys? Why did Jane suffer as much as she did and others managed to get away less scathed? I agree that our cultures revolve around the standards imposed on us, whether they be health-related or image-related. Take me, for instance. I'm half Ukrainian, half Italian. I remember asking my mother about what Ukrainian women are most prominent for when I was a kid, only for her to queerly smile at me and say being hot. All my life, the expectations imposed on Slavic women presided over me like a shadow I could not get rid of. Ukrainian figures like Mila Kunis, Slavic supermodels, and the ripoff sex ads I sometimes came across online preached the notion that I was supposed to look a certain way because of my heritage. But that does not explain the bigger issue. Although ED is pervasive, there are certainly more people that aren't affected than people that are affected. Until I myself developed a disorder, I too believed that ED revolved around the prospect of appealing to beauty standards, but that has been shown not to be the case. Anorexia, for instance, was first recognized as a condition long before Western cultural standards rose, in 1874. And yet, it goes even farther back, like in the case of St. Catherine of Siena, who died of starvation in the year 1380, after 17 years of anorexia. Her diary remained, and we were able to unearth one of the most historically early recorded onsets of anorexia. Her case was called anorexia mirabilis, an extreme form of holy fasting. And in an interview I had with the marvelous Carie Arnold, the author of two of the books that I heavily relied on for my research, she revealed to me another instance of when anorexia had little to nothing to do with endeavors to look a certain way. Studies conducted in the 1980s in Hong Kong of people diagnosed with anorexia showed that yes, they were underweight, and yes, they were indeed starving themselves, and yes, they were afraid to gain all that weight back, but they never expressed any variation of body image issues. Cases of ED have also been reported among the Amish and in Ghana, which were not impacted by Western cultural beauty standards. According to genetic studies published in 1988 that conducted the research on 45 different twin pairs in the UK, in which at least one twin was diagnosed with anorexia, a genetic predisposition constitutes up to 80% of someone's risk of developing an eating disorder. More recent research posits that relatives of those with ED's chance of developing a disorder is 12 times larger than the chance of those in the general population. In fact, more than 100 studies have determined that ED is driven by genes, not culture. But then again, my disorder had not been engraved in stone. I wasn't born bulimic, and I'm definitely not invalidating the notion that the environment contributes to ED, because it does. For instance, 3 years after American television was introduced to Fiji, a location with cases of ED very rare and where fatness was admired among women, over two-thirds had dieted to lose weight and 11.3% had attempted to lose weight through vomiting. Basically, the community is very divided as to what we should put more emphasis on, nature or nurture. But why I've struggled and why my friends have not could be justified by the discrepancies in their genetic makeup. What if the 11.3% of women who had resorted to vomiting had a predisposition that was triggered by the rise of American TV? 70% of those with anorexia nervosa and 75% of those with bulimia nervosa have something called comorbidities. This essentially means that they are afflicted by other emotional, behavioral, or psychological issues. A study conducted of more than 2,400 people hospitalized for an eating disorder confirmed that 97% of them had a co-occurring condition such as depression, anxiety, OCD, PTSD, and an alcohol or substance use disorder. But these are just statistics, and I have no right to generalize on account of them. Everyone's experience with ED is unique and different, and everyone deserves the right to hear and be heard. I'm only one teenager. I can't speak for the millions of us out there. I cannot speak for people with acute anorexia or binge eating disorder because although I may have experienced symptoms, I'm not diagnosed with them. What I can speak for, however, is my own experience. I'm a perfectionist, which is extremely common in individuals with eating disorders. I had a breakdown on the first day of my creative writing education because I felt as though I wasn't good enough. I was in hysterics when I got my first B in algebra, and worse, I've always had an inherent sense of competition that compelled me to one-up everyone in everything. This trait was especially prominent when I plummeted into my disorder head first. If I couldn't be the smartest, I would be the skinniest, and when I determined that I needed help and that I was sabotaging my own body rather than refining it like my perfectionism dictated, a cruel part of me still preached that I could not recover. That I had to even be the sickest. I also used to regularly partake in almost ceremonial acts of self-harm, something I'd been doing since I was in the sixth grade. When my bulimia onsetted, my self-harm was replaced with my binging and purging cycles. However, months into my illness, my thighs felt my razor once again, and between 25 and 40% of people with ED regularly engage in self-harm. The most harmful misconception about self-harm is that those who do it are using it as a means of manipulation and attention-seeking, and I myself have been called an attention-seeker on multiple occasions. Before my struggles with bulimia arose, I had put myself on a rigid protein shake diet. a meal replacement shake for breakfast and dinner, and a salad for lunchtime. When I ran out of protein shakes, I determined that the only way I could lose weight was not eating at all. I hardly ate anything for an entire week following my diet. The obsessive perfectionistic trait that I demonstrate made it so where many would stop, I kept going. When I started eating again, the damage was already so prominent in my bulimic rituals. I assure you, the damage that results from any eating disorder is substantial. Every time I purged and every time I relapsed, I paved the way for health complications such as gastric rupture, which is fatal in 80% of cases, dehydration, pancreatitis, seizures, tooth erosion, kidney damage, and other equally as nasty conditions to infiltrate my life. My history with bulimia has significantly increased my chances of developing diabetes. The danger is that those with anorexia sometimes don't even know they may be subjecting their own bodies to include low body temperature, insomnia, iron deficiency, seizures, an inability to properly fight infection, muscle atrophy, and more. Sufferers of both bulimia and anorexia experience constipation and amenorrhea, the absence of menstruation, which often leads to bone loss. That's because a ceasing of menstruation, even short-term, decreases bone density, which could lead to osteoporosis. Roughly 75% of adolescent girls with anorexia show a dramatic decrease in bone density as opposed to the girls their age who are not afflicted with this disorder. Those with binge eating disorder are more likely to become obese, be afflicted with heart disease, high cholesterol, and blood pressure, as well as type 2 diabetes. Eating disorders also damage our brains, reducing our capacity to retain information, make decisions, as well as our efficiency and even how clearly we perceive ourselves. The insula, the part of the brain that helps communication between other areas of the brain and that manages interoceptive awareness, which is a process that monitors the internal state of the body, like our hunger, our thirst, our body temperature, and even body image, doesn't receive enough blood flow. People with anorexia, for instance, have trouble sensing hunger and receiving pleasure in the taste of food. Said hunger is dampened by abnormalities surrounding hormones leptin and insulin, the hormones that help evoke satiety, and ghrelin, neuropeptide Y, and BDNF that provoke appetite. Let's take binge eating, for instance. When a person constantly overeats, their body adapts to their diet and they become resistant to insulin and leptin. With anorexia, the opposite can happen. It's counterproductive to try to pressure someone with an ED case to listen to their body because their bodies are systematically adapting and shifting in order to survive. Someone with anorexia doesn't just get up in the morning one day, look in the mirror, determine they've done enough, and resume eating. They physically and mentally can't do so because not only are they not as receptive to hormones like ghrelin, abnormalities in the insula cause them to even feel repulsion when nourishing themselves. They can't determine whether they are too thin for their own good because their minds are not functioning in the way they should be. Their perceptions of themselves are distorted and unreliable. The rise of virtual reality-centered therapy has helped the science community realize this. A researcher called Giuseppe Riva used two different high-tech approaches to aid patients in evaluating their own body size. The first involved having sufferers choose two different full-body avatars, one of which would be what they think they look like and the other what they would like to look like. Following that, the patient's actual measurements would be transmuted into a model of what they actually look like, and often the patient being evaluated was smaller than the standards they had for themselves. The second technique involved having patients select the virtual chair that would ideally fit their posteriors, only for the patients to realize the chairs they had chosen had actually been way too large for them. The inquiry I've had throughout my journey was whether I've always had interoceptive issues or whether they onsetted as my bulimia did. With ED research, we have yet to find out, if we ever do find the means to. There are many things I still haven't covered in this presentation, things like compulsive exercise and the punishment paradox, the adapted to flee famine hypothesis that theorizes that individuals with anorexia have trouble feeling hunger and are compelled to refrain from eating due to genetic ties to hunter-gatherers from the Pleistocene time period, and elevated levels of serotonin in people with eating disorders due to abnormalities in its HT2A receptor. But explaining all of these to you would involve me having to either hold you hostage for hours at a time or write a book, none of these things being something I could accomplish today. The point of this presentation has been to inform you, but it was also to elucidate that supermodels and Western culture's beauty standards are not to blame. ED isn't something that targets only Caucasian adolescent girls, and assuming so would be denying the other sufferers treatment just like so many professionals are used to, and some even do today. I admit that when I first started working on this project, it was for somewhat selfish reasons. Sure, I wanted to help the environment around me, but I also wanted to make myself feel better. I wanted to scramble out of the ditch I had dug for myself, and when I started researching, a love for the correlation between biology and psychology sparked within me. But something else that was evoked was a yearning to incorporate the community of artists at my school into something that appears so subjective and yet so factual at the same time. I wanted to challenge my own perfectionistic traits, and I wanted to help amplify the voices of my peers, the voices of other ED sufferers, because if there is anything I'm certain about regarding ED and ED research is that it is much too stigmatized and overlooked. If we do not acknowledge what ED entails and what it means and has meant for our society, we will be condemning millions of people to a miserable existence devoid of proper treatment. We would be condemning them to death, which befalls up to 20% of those diagnosed with an ED case and undergoing treatment. Today, we are not only celebrating the great courage it takes for an anorexic individual to start eating, a bulimic individual to stop purging, a binger to stop binging, and the other amazing achievements those with other eating disorders like avoidant or restrictive food intake disorder or rumination disorder have executed in their recovery. We are also celebrating art. Today, more than ever, we need to remind ourselves that beauty does not lie in other people's eyes, but in our own. My worth does not lie in my body, it lies in my independence, my intelligence, my diligence, and my benevolence, and so does yours. Thank you.
I'm fading from my eyes like you're smoking. round body. This all started with your shadow, its middling curve on the hot concrete. The length and width of your legs morphed according to the sun's place in the sky. And you believed in it. It was natural. You used daylight as a benchmark. If midday was a bloated shade, you would steam vegetables and only eat the broccoli. At night, you had no image on the street, so you stared in glass windows indoors, walking slowly to let people into office buildings. They didn't know they were blocking your desperate reflection, no sun behind arm flap. They didn't know you were staring down your thighs. Or maybe they did, but they had scales and mirrors at home and didn't carve themselves out with the sun's absence like this. You felt superior somehow, as if relying on sidewalk shade made this poetic. Nothing was poetic. The swollen belly, the secret scraping of the plate, rapid scanning of ingredient labels, the way you still can't look at your shadow, or how you still prefer night because you can look down and see only gravel, only heavy ground, only the solid weight of the world.